Well, thank you all for coming. Thank you for the opportunity to share what I think is some not just exciting stuff, but some very relevant stuff that many of you will either directly or indirectly face throughout the course of your lives and certainly your medical lives. It's pretty funny, they call it dining with the doctor, but I didn't read the small print, which is the doctor doesn't actually dine. So it's a good thing I had big breakfast. Just tell you a little bit about myself. I've been in Florida now for a little bit over 10 years. I did my general surgery training at the University of Texas in Houston and part of my cardiac surgery training there with Dr. Denton Cooley, and then went out to the University of Utah and did 2 years of research in biomedical engineering and artificial heart work, and then 2 years cardiothoracic surgery fellowship. So even when I say that, I get tired thinking about it, and I always think I should be older and taller after having done all that. I will get older. I will not get any taller. So today we'll talk a little bit about beating heart surgery. I don't know, some of you may have had heart surgery. Certainly all of you at least know somebody that has had heart surgery, because heart disease is certainly the number one killer in North America. Interestingly, and we'll look at some of this going forward, disturbingly, there's still a lot of opportunity for education in not just professional circles, but as well as the lay opportunity as well. When I give a lot of talks and I'll ask the question, I said, what's the number one killer in the United States of men? And almost everybody gets that right. Everyone says heart disease. And then interesting, I'll ask the same question among women. I said, what is the number one killer of women? And it's frequently that they do not get the answer right. And I hear a lot of different answers here, breast cancer a lot, or different type of gynecologic cancer. And it's actually heart disease. And if you take a look at death among women, heart disease actually accounts for more than the next two or three causes after that. So it's not something that historically we have thought much about, cardiac disease in women. We'll touch upon some of these issues, but it's an important sub-interest of mine in cardiac disease, and it does have some relevancy to some of the items that we'll talk about today with regards to beating heart surgery. You may have researched this. Everybody's becoming very smart now with the internet. You can Google anything in the world and get a couple of million hits about it. But I will tell you, and I'm somebody who does that from time to time as well, it is a little bit complex, though, to try to sort through that. You know, you get 2 million responses. Which are the 5 good ones? Because some of them are advertising like everything else, and some of them are contentious in that you don't really know what the right answer is. So we'll kind of walk through the steps of that and try to be as objective as I can. OPCAB, or what we call beating heart surgery, or off-pump surgery. Traditionally, bypass surgery has been done with a heart-lung machine, and you've probably all heard that term. It's a very elegant device, and it takes all the blood out of the body, it circulates it, and puts it back into the body. And it is really a wonderfully consistent way to support the body during surgery, but it also is pretty invasive. Could you imagine taking every blood cell out of your body, crushing it through a pump, and sending it back to you? It doesn't sound like a lot of fun. Most people are not going to sign up for that electively. So there has been a set of technologies that has made bypass surgery more kind, if you will, from a physiologic standpoint, and it allows the patients to recover better, better fast tracking, reduced complications. Specifically, we have found it to be very effective in some of the more high-risk patients, and we'll talk about that, and also in female patients, as we talked about. OPCAB, beating heart surgery. So we talked a little bit about conventional bypass. We stop the heart, we use a heart-lung machine, we cool the patient down to help preserve end organs while we do the operation. The advantage is it gives us a still field, so nothing's really moving, and it also gives us a relatively bloodless field, so it's a little bit easier to see things and to do things. Beating heart surgery is sort of the opposite. We avoid using the heart-lung machine. We use a series of what we call stabilization devices, and we'll look at those shortly, and it allows us to operate in the heart as it beats and as the lungs function, and it's a little bit of the thinking of how mechanics, you know, fix the engine in your car. You know, it's not so bad to fix the engine when the car is off. You can take things apart, take a little bit of time and fix it. Could you imagine trying to fix the engine as it's running? And that's a little bit about how I think about how to do beating heart surgery. This is a graphic of what this looks like. This is actually a real cartoon-generated graphic. And you can see the patient's head would be up at the bottom of the graph, and their feet would be down that way. I'd be somewhere around that way. And the first thing you see is the chest incision. This is what we call a sternal retractor, and that just holds open the incision so we get to operate on it. And then these two devices, which look a little bit like octopus type of tentacles, are the stabilization devices that I discussed earlier. This one holds the what we call the apex of the heart or the edge of the heart. And this one, which looks a little bit like a pair of skis here, and if you're able to see the bottom of it, it looks like the suction cups in an octopus tentacle. And that allows us to stabilize this one little part of the heart. It's probably about 1.5 square inches. So the remainder of the heart continues to beat. This area doesn't, at least not very much, and that's one of the arteries that we might operate on. So all you have to do is open up the chest, do that, operate on a vessel that's about 1 millimeter big, not make any mistakes, and go home. It's not so bad. This is just a little bit different look at one of the devices we use. Again, you can see it sort of has that octopus tentacle characteristic about it. And I think the important thing to understand is that when you look at these devices, they look pretty simple, really, when you think about it. And, you know, I've always subscribed to the idea that there's no genius without simplicity. So if you could do the same process in an all things being equal model, more simple, that usually makes more sense. These are pretty neat little devices. These little things that look like lifesavers, they're not really the thing. That's the thing. So there are these shunts. So one question I get a lot is, well, Dr. Allen, this sounds pretty good, but what happens when you open up one of the coronary arteries as the heart's beating? You know, doesn't blood go spraying all over the place? And there's a little bit of blood, but for the most part, there's very little blood because we insert these little shunts, which are really just these cylinders, and they actually go inside the artery as we open it. So we're still able to feed the heart with critical blood supply as we're operating on it. So really just some very simple devices, very, for the most part, inexpensive. On the other side, there is the CO2 blower mister. It's kind of interesting. Industry, when they were helping develop these products, I had the opportunity to work with, and it's so funny how, I guess, more American industry than others spends a lot of marketing interest on how to name things. So I don't even know how much energy they put towards, do they name this the CO2 blower mister or Mr. Blower? Remarkable stuff. So obviously blower mister won. I think it was on a coin toss. You know. So benefits. Anytime you come to listen to one of these talks, anytime you consider your own healthcare choices or your family's healthcare choices, one of the things that we have to understand are what are the goals, what are the risks, what are the benefits? And somebody should be able to very clearly at about a 8th grade level of English describe to you what it is that they're doing and what are the relative pros and what are the relative cons. So I believe in fact-based world. So my job is to collect those facts and to try to deliver them to the patients and the service lines that I work in. And towards the bottom, and I don't expect you to read all these articles, but that's where this information comes from. So you got to be a little bit focused on when someone gets up there and they give you a talk about whatever it is. If there's no support to it, I can say anything I want. I could say that I'm 5'10 and that I'm a really good golfer, you know, but unless I show you my golf game and get a legitimate, you know, ruler, you can't really tell whether that's true or not. So with regards to OPCAB, what does that mean, and what does that mean in regard to high-risk patients? So heart surgery, on some level, has become the victim of its own success. And what does that mean? If you take a look nationally, as far as results, and I'm talking specifically about bypass surgery, not aneurysm surgery, not valve surgery, sort of routine bypass surgery. Anybody have any idea what the mortality would be for that? Any guess? What percentage of people die from that? 20? 20? I hope you're not a heart surgeon. No, it's actually about 2%. All right, pretty remarkable, all right, that I could describe to somebody, we could open up their chest, give them all these really powerful medicines, maybe not put them on a heart-lung machine, fix things, put them back together, send them home, and only 2% of people die from that. Because the other side of that is, what percent of people do you think die if you don't fix their heart? It's about 100, you know, or pretty close, which is why I have a very easy sales job. You know, I get to say, well, here's the operation, this is what it looks like, here's your defined risk. And by the way, if you don't do this, things aren't going to work out so well for you. So you can imagine I have a pretty captive audience. So selling the idea is not hard. Trying to educate people to make good decisions, though, can be sort of hard. So the reason for bringing that point up is when mortality is so low, it's a little bit hard to differentiate different types of techniques just based on mortality. So if you're starting off with a 2% or so expected mortality, you know, if the other process that you're talking about, in this case, beating heart surgery, a new medicine, it doesn't really matter. If the results are 1.8% or 2.1%, those numbers may look big to you, but they're not really significant. It's as if, you know, you step on the scale and one day you're 150 and one day you're 152. You go, oh my God, I've gained 2 pounds. But that's not really meaningful data. So part of my job is to filter that stuff for the people I work with to have them interpret, you know, what's meaningful, what's not meaningful. So the point is, I cannot look anybody in the eye and tell you that I know for a fact that in all comers, beating heart surgery will reduce mortality. It may or may not for certain subgroups, but what I can tell you is the stuff that we'll talk about here momentarily on the slide, because it's not just about death. Death is a pretty easy item to deal with. You know, you don't have to deal with it very much, actually. These other things are very important, and frequently, because so many people do well, these are the things that occur much more frequently than 2%. Reduced transfusions and bleeding. Conservative blood management has become a very important issue in healthcare systems for good reasons. And I sort of backdoored into this in my career early on because I'd always practiced conservative blood management. And what I started to notice was that I got a lot of patients who were Jehovah's Witness patients. And I started to think about that a little bit. And for those of you that may or may not be familiar with Jehovah's Witness patients, those are patients who will not accept blood transfusions. And that's a little bit iffy when you're getting ready to do heart surgery to not accept a blood transfusion. I think about that as doing a high wire walk like you see in the circus and not having a net. You know, the reason they're so bold up there is because they know if they drop, they're going to fall into a net and they'll be okay. It's kind of like, I don't plan on transfusing patients, but I certainly know that somewhere around 25 or 30% of them might need a blood transfusion. It's a little bit different when you don't have the flexibility to do that. But the reason that those patients tended to find our practice is because we did have that conservative approach. And as I thought through it, I said, well, why don't we just take care of everybody that way? You know, why do we take care of the Jehovah's Witness patients differently? Why don't we have that conservative blood management approach? And beating heart surgery is one of the ways to do that. Every time somebody gets transfused a unit of blood, it reduces their immune system. It increases their risk of death. It increases their risk of pneumonia, wound infection, any number of bad things. So we take that very seriously. Reduced inotropes, what does that mean? Those are the really powerful medicines. One of them that you might be familiar with is adrenaline or epinephrine. Those are the very powerful medicines that we frequently use in heart surgery. We need less of them when we do beating heart surgery. That has a lot of positive benefit because those medicines also have very bad side effects. They can cause other problems in the body and other organs. Reduced arrhythmias. There was a talk last month Dr. Bryce gave about atrial fibrillation, right? Very common arrhythmia, most common one in the United States. And it's a very common one associated with major surgery, heart surgery included. So we're able to reduce that as well. Reduces stroke, reduces some other items. Sternal wound infections, cerebral emboli, things like strokes, or what we call cognitive dysfunction. If any of you have had heart surgery or anyone close to you has had heart surgery, you talk to them for the first couple of hours or the first couple of days or the first couple of weeks after surgery, and you know there's something missing sometimes. It almost always comes back. But I'd start with the phrase almost always, and it could take some period of time, and it's obviously distressing to the patient and distressing to their family. And the reason is these type of operations put an especially large strain on all of what we call end organs, brain, lung, liver, kidney, not just the heart. The wonderful thing at the end of heart surgery, the one thing that's better is the heart. But nothing else is necessarily better, and certainly not right away. Beating heart surgery reduces that, what we call cognitive dysfunction, and also reduces the risk of stroke. And then lastly, we talk about hospital length of stay. There is this idea afoot, and I've been on both sides, I've had family in the hospitals as well, of hospitals and insurance companies are just trying to push me out of the hospital. You know, they just want to get me out of here, all right? Now, I can't really speak to all of the agenda items on that, because certainly you could anticipate what some of them might be, economic and practical. But I will tell you, short hospital stays are most importantly best for the patient. It's not best for me, it's not best for the healthcare system, it's best for the patient. Short in the sense of short and neat. In other words, you're not trying to bully people out of the hospital. That is a bad idea, turns out to be have bad outcomes and frequent readmissions. By short hospital stays, I mean efficient, succinct things. After I do an operation, when that patient's left the operating room, I have fixed all the things that are broken, so to speak. They might be in the hospital for another 3 or 10 days, but there's those 3 or 4 or 5 very intimate hours that I spend with them, if you will, fixing things. Everything that happens after is healing, right? And healing is sort of a comprehensive concept. It is about pain management, the wound coming together, blood pressure, other type of things. So beating heart surgery, because it is less of a stress to the body in general, would make sense. We'll also have a shorter length of stay because it doesn't take as long to recover. What I think is a fantastic thing that we've been able to do is what we call ultra fast track patients. What does that mean? If you've seen most patients after most major surgeries and almost after every open heart surgery, they don't look especially robust. You go to see them in those first minutes or hours, and they have a bunch of tubes in, they're sedated and or paralyzed. It's a pretty graphic thing to take a look at. With beating heart surgery in the appropriately trained team, when we're done with that operation, in the operating room, we take the breathing tube out. Like, we're done. Like, done, done. You know, there's done, like, with your kids, and then there's, like, done, done. And we're done. And by the time that patient comes back to the intensive care unit, which is where they go right after surgery, they're awake. You know, they're awake and somewhat alert. So it's a pretty powerful thing when I can go to the patient's family, to referring physicians, to the nurses, and say, hey, Mr. Smith, you know, it's not going to be 3, 6, or 10, or 20 hours before they wake up. They're up now. So you might anticipate how much more quickly they can recover, you know, from the things that happened to them afterwards. They can communicate better. They can tell us when they're anxious versus when they're having pain versus when they're not being able to breathe well. You know, really a very powerful clinical tool to have. Other benefits, you can see reduced relative risk of stroke. You know, strokes are probably the most horrible complication that I face as a heart surgeon. Almost anything else I can kind of fix or kind of support or kind of get help with. You know, strokes are very powerful, devastating things. Some of them can be small, some of them can be really quite serious. Atrial fibrillation, we talked a little bit about. It's a very serious chronic illness. It has historically, I think, been a little bit underappreciated on how much it could really affect someone's longevity. I would tell you statistically, there's got to be somewhere between 4 and 8 of you in the audience that have atrial fibrillation or did have atrial fibrillation. You know, if not managed well, you know, it increases your mortality. Just somebody walking around in the universe with atrial fibrillation versus not, it increases your risk of mortality because the atrial fibrillation can throw off clots that create strokes, and also the blood thinning medicine that we need to be on can cause bleeding that can cause other problems. So if I can prevent that from happening, I've done a good thing for our patients. And then, of course, wound infection. Decreased blood transfusions lead to decreased wound infections. High-risk patients. You know, I've thought about the what I call candidacy for patients as I've thought about a little bit in my blood management experience, which I shared with you a little bit earlier. Patient population is aging. Patients have more complex disease today than they did 5, 10, 20 years ago, and they'll have more complex disease 5 or 10, 20 years from now. So what we have found is beating heart surgery is especially productive in these higher risk patients. But when you start to look at it, almost all my patients are higher risk patients. You know, I don't operate on a lot of people that are less than 65. I don't operate on a lot of people that don't have high blood pressure and or diabetes and or renal failure and or thyroid disease. You know, the list goes on. Anytime I get a 50-year-old golfer with one single problem, I try to tackle him to the floor and bring him to the operating room before someone finds out, because that's about the best thing I have going in my clinical practice. Having said that, it happens probably as many as 3 times in a year. It is more representative of a national practice of a more aged population that are complex. So while many will agree beating heart surgery is favorable for the more complex patients, there's still some debate about does it have benefit for the more routine patients. And to me, it didn't really make sense. It was kind of the thinking about blood management. You know, why don't we treat everybody like a complex patient? We're not going to hurt anybody who gets treated like a complex or a higher risk patient. If they're lower risk, they may get a little extra treatment, but we're certainly not going to do anything negative towards them. What do these patients face? And we already touched on this. More need for transfusion, rhythm problems, breathing problems, medicines, mortality. We talked a little bit again about outcomes and about how do you know how you're doing. Well, there's plenty of data, and you know I can go on for an entire separate talk just talking about data. It's not really necessary, I don't think, in this venue, but I'd be happy to answer questions at the end to discuss those a little bit. But across what are the most common types of complications, and again, we looked at them, atrial fibrillation, transfusions, respiratory illnesses, inotropes, and cognitive dysfunction. This particular study was pretty interesting, and if I don't know how well it transmits here, but this is something we call in medical research a meta-analysis. So every so often, if you pay attention to the lay media, you'll hear on the radio, TV, whatever your media sources are, well, there's a paper from the New England Journal of Medicine, right? There's a paper from the New York Times, so on and so forth, some esteemed colleague, some so-and-so expert. But if you really pay close attention, a lot of it is just point counterpoint, right? Like, you know, one day they tell you this is healthy to eat, and then the next month they tell you that's going to cause cancer, and then the next month it's something else, and that's, you know, the way life goes on. And I'm not exactly sure how that happens in the media, but the point is there's a lot of contention. Well, a meta-analysis says, well, you know what? We're not going to just really focus on an individual study. We're going to take a look at all the studies. So anything for, in this example, it has to do, say, with bypass surgery. So Dr. Puskas, great researcher, good guy, he's the chief of cardiac surgery at Emory University, was the lead researcher on this project, and he said, we're going to take a look at all 45 studies. So they took 45 different papers, different agendas, different parts of the country, different institutions, and we're going to take all their data, thousands and thousands of patients, and we're going to put it together, and we're going to do an apples and apples comparison. And you can get a sense from the slide here of what are the material differences. And you can see all of them really favored beating heart surgery. So for the people that look at the facts of it, not the bias, not the personal spin, not the geographic preferences, this is a better way to do things. We talked about women. It's kind of funny, I had to redo the slide because it started off with something like women are high risk. I think it was kind of a subliminal thing. And then I had to put the colon in there. Women, specifically a high risk group. And they are. It's kind of interesting. We talked earlier about women have the same type of cardiac mortality risk that men do as far as leading cause of death. But what's interesting, and this is another opportunity to educate ourselves, when you take a look at sort of pound for pound, age for age, so in other words, if I took apples and apples comparison, 70-year-old male, certain medical conditions, certain body weight and so forth. I took a 70-year-old female, same exact everything. So it's not as if we're comparing, you know, obese males to small females or older males to younger females. So if you pretty much cloned them with the exception of male versus female, and then I asked you, I said, who do you think has a higher mortality walking in the door for pretty much anything, a stent, bypass surgery, and whatnot? Because we have this sense that women have greater longevity, and they do. But once they've been diagnosed with heart disease, they do less well. Okay? And there's not what we call a predictive model or a risk stratification model, which puts in all these factors into account. Age, how well your heart works, other morbidities that you might have. Every single one of them, if you're a female, you lose points. And there's two reasons for that. One, which is kind of obvious, and one which was not so obvious to me. The obvious one to me, having worked on a lot of people, is females have smaller arteries than males. 100-pound female, 100-pound male, females have smaller arteries. They tend to block a little bit differently than do men. The other thing is women present much later in the course of their disease, and we think more about this in cancer than we do about cardiac disease than men do, by an average of about 3 years. So if you have a more typical male that has that crushing type of chest pain, right? Generally, they seek attention about 3 years before equivalent females. There's a lot of different ideas of why that might be. Some of the ideas go around that females perceive pain a little bit differently. They don't exhibit that classic crushing type of chest pain. It's more, I don't feel quite right. I feel sad today. There's something not quite right. I'm tired. I'm whatnot. So we don't focus on that. And then frankly, a lot of it is awareness. You know, we're not thinking. I mean, you know how many people are in utter disbelief when I talk to them and I show them the pictures about what their illness is? I can't be. You know, I'm only fill in the blank. I'm only 40-something. I'm only 70-something. You know, how could I possibly have heart disease? Well, again, you know, in the fact-based world, by the time I'm involved in somebody's care, we already have pretty hard data. It's not my opinion or my thought. Let me share with you this picture. And you don't need to go to medical school to sort of get the idea of what looks relatively normal and what looks relatively abnormal. So this slide completes the idea of being female has a relatively higher risk factor. You know, nothing to be cataclysmic about, nothing to start running to the doors and, oh my God, we're all going to die from heart disease, because that's certainly not the case, especially when you have systems that are aware of this and you have systems that can anticipate special issues with women's health. Traditionally, women's health usually focuses around breast disease or OBGYN illnesses. And they are very important. But still, if you're looking at it from a global, macro medical standpoint, cardiac disease is still really the biggest issue. Potential factors in high-risk patients. We talked about some of these later clinical presentation. They tend to present a little bit more acutely, meaning they've waited, now they can't wait anymore. They tend to be a little bit older age at presentation, and that has a whole set of risks that go with it. More diabetes, more problems with the ventricle, smaller arteries, and because of that, the way we do the operations are a little bit affected. One of these are actually quite important, less use of LITA graft. For those of you that have had surgery, you might be more familiar with this. Sometimes we call it LIMA graft. It's the left internal thoracic artery. That's one of the arteries we use to help do the bypasses. Women tend to have smaller ones and more difficult to use it. Again, another study taking a look at better outcomes. This actually was probably the single most pivotal study. This one came out of Duke, actually, and showed that women had about 32% lower mortality op-cab versus what we call on-cab. This is kind of a busy slide, but why I think this is important is this was a recommendation at the society level. So what does that mean? Society level, you might be more familiar with things like American Medical Association, American Heart Association. Well, for what I do, there's something called the STS, or the Society of Thoracic Surgeons, and that's the largest national professional society for heart surgeons. So by the time heart surgeons can get together as a group, and there's, I don't know, a couple thousand of us, let's say, in the world, and come up with a consensus statement, that means two things. One, it's a pretty powerful statement because you can't get anybody to agree on anything. Two, it also means the information is a little bit old at that point. That's not because somebody wrote a paper on Monday and the consensus occurred on Tuesday. It takes many, many papers over many, many years before there's a body of evidence where a conservative group of surgeons will get together and say, we think this is the best way to go ahead and do things. And as you can tell here, in this specific experience, taking a look at what we call off-pump surgery versus on-pump surgery, had actually better survival. Now, I will be fair in telling you, not every single person believes in that, but this is a pretty powerful consensus and a pretty powerful study, and there's certainly no studies that are going to tell you that they do less well. You know, they may do the same, but there appears to be some benefit that they do better. Again, a little more data. This I tend to use more on some of the physician talks, but I think the important take-home points to this is that better improvement, better survival, and less of what we call MACE. And MACE is not the stuff you spray on each other when you're mad. MACE is what we call major adverse cardiac events. So that means let's not get necessarily so focused on whether the risk of stroke or heart attack or arrhythmia or repeat heart failure. Let's just take them all together. All right, let's just take them all together because they're all bad. We could debate on which is worse, but let's take them all together and compare them. And when you do that, when you look at relative MACE results, they're much better in op-cab as well. Specifically, we'll just pick out one of the groups, renal dysfunction, pretty high risk group. Cardiac disease is a marker. You know, cardiac disease is a marker for hardening of the arteries. I remember growing up, I used to hear the term all the time. You know, my mom was a little bit maybe histrionic, but everybody, as far as she was concerned, actively had cancer and or hardening the arteries, or the same. I mean, everybody was always dying all the time. And she was only a little bit right, because we are all dying a little bit all the time, but not actively dying all the time. And my job, I'm in the living game, you know, so my job is to pretty much unwind everything she told me growing up to this point. So the point is, when patients are diagnosed with coronary artery disease, there's about a 1 in 3 chance they have other artery problems someplace else, right? Those are the people that have risks of abdominal aneurysms, clotted blood in their legs, problems with the kidneys, problems with the brain. So part of our regimen in taking care of heart surgery patients and getting them ready for heart surgery is what we call a pervasive screening, all right? Because I've also become accustomed to a phrase which I don't like, but I've come to respect because it actually does have some foundation. You know, the one which is operation went well, patient didn't do well, right? Have you ever heard that? You get that idea, right? There's actually truth to that, and the truth to that goes around this. As I said earlier, the thing that is fixed at the end of heart surgery, it's the heart, right? I haven't fixed anyone's kidney, I haven't fixed anyone's ears or legs or kidneys or anything like that. So that's kind of the biggest challenge that we face. And the best way to avoid those issues are to find them before they happen. So when we do heart surgery screening, we'll take a look at the carotid arteries, we'll take a look at the abdominal aorta and the kidneys, and we'll also take a look at the arteries in the legs. Right, some people will perceive that, well, Dr. Allen, you and this system, you're just trying to make more money. You're just trying to find things on us, you know. Well, first thought is, I don't need to find other things to do. You know, I'm plenty busy, the hospital's plenty busy. It's not just figured we'll go mining, see what we're going to find today. It's either there or it's not there. And the important thing is to prevent a future complication. Because nobody really likes when I go out and I talk to the family and say, hey, you know what, your mom did great and we fixed her heart and let me tell you how wonderful a heart surgeon I am. And the next day I have to go, yeah, but the bad news is her kidneys don't work anymore. Now she's going to be on dialysis. It kind of erases all the good feelings. Or she's had a stroke that maybe I could prevent, or any number of possibilities. This is pretty serious business. This is cardiac disease. So that is the thinking behind it. It's not somebody trying to run up the bill or they're just kind of curious today, thought, we'll see how Mrs. Smith's carotid artery is doing. You know, there's real facts behind this, and I think ultimately helps deliver better care. The kidneys specifically, they tend to always be stressed at the time of any major operation. Obviously, their function is to filter the blood and to create fluid balance. Patients that have had kidney problems before tend to do better with beating heart surgery. It puts less of a stress on the kidneys. So as you come to think through this, well, we get more of the female patients, we get more of the kidney patients, we get more of the Jehovah's Witness patients. So, you know, these are subsets of higher risk group patients come to find beating heart surgery as a better alternative. Now, for the ones that we're not going to talk about today, who are as everybody else, people with pretty good kidneys, people that are not as old, men versus women, do you think they don't benefit from this? Of course they do. It's like when you put premium fuel in your car. You know, some cars need premium fuel to work. But the premium fuel you put in the car that doesn't need it, it doesn't have a negative effect, right? It's still a positive thing. It's just a question of whether you think that's the right way to spend resources. So in an effort to try to uniform the way we take care of these patients, we just take care of everybody the same way. Why not give them all the best opportunity? Treat them like they're all high risk. In an effort to make this even better, if you ever get the opportunity to see heart surgery, hopefully not have the opportunity to have heart surgery, is after we've opened up the chest and even when we've used a beating heart technique, one of the Achilles heels of that is you still have to manipulate the aorta, and the aorta is the big artery that comes out of the chest. And as I said, if you have blocked arteries in the heart, you can have blocked arteries other places, and that's an area where you can create some stroke or you can create some of these cerebral dysfunction because these little plaques break off. So some pretty neat technology now. And I don't know if I have a picture coming up, we'll see. But there are these devices where we could actually insert them into the aorta as the heart is beating. Gives us a small, I don't know, about the size of a dime or so, maybe just a little bit bigger, area where we can work, where it's a relatively bloodless field. So it's a pretty compelling way to go ahead and do things. What does that do? It helps reduce what we call atherosclerotic embolization. And the graph on the left, which is the green graph, talks a little bit about neuropsych data and number of what we call embolic signals, meaning these little plaques that break off. And as you might expect, you know, the larger the, or the greater the number of the plaques, the greater the opportunity for these neuropsych deficits. You can see on the slide next to it, taking a look at cardiac and stroke complications, much lower when you don't have to manipulate the aorta or so. One of the last items we'll talk about before I answer your questions is a little bit about the cost. You really can't read anything in the popular media anymore that doesn't talk about some type of healthcare reform. And this feeds back to the idea of moving patients through the system more expeditiously is not just better for the patients, it's also better for the system, and certainly there is some cost issues. All these things need to get paid for. You know, we all want everything for nothing, but we all have a certain amount of responsibility. And you can see here from some of the studies cited, OpCab reduces hospital stay by about 2 days or so, pretty compelling, and also reduces cost. You know, so who wouldn't sign up for something where you can get the same or better quality, but it costs less? So it's not as if it's just one more of those new procedures or one more of those new technologies that just adds on cost. Stroke alone is really the major issue that contributes to that. You reduce stroke, you reduce cost. Medical economic specialists will tell you that a stroke, if you're looking at it from the cold, hard math, you know, what does a stroke cost? Right, everyone understands the clinical impact. Stroke is going to cost somewhere between $80,000 and $100,000, you know, for the system to take care of somebody with a stroke. That's the short-term cost. That's the cost within 30 days from a hospitalization. Can't imagine what that would be if you extrapolate that over the number of years in a patient's life. And it has nothing to do with the personal family devastation of having had a stroke. So these are important issues. You know, this is not whether my scar is this big, or, you know, whether I chose menu item A, you know, for lunch, or menu item B. You know, these are really compelling issues. For those of you that read deeper into this, and maybe you have the opportunity to discuss with other healthcare professionals, is it good or is it bad? Some people will push back against beating heart surgery. They'll tell you that the grafts don't stay open as well. So in other words, the quality of the work is not as good, that there's not as much clinical benefit as described, that you can't do as many bypasses, you know, versus other ways. We can go through some other data, but I just want to give you a sort of a broad overview. That's really not the case. There's plenty of good third-party data that will tell you that we can use this graft sequence. So the lima we talked about before, it's the left internal mammary artery. That's the main graft that we try to use in surgery to the main artery that we operate in surgery, which is the left anterior descending artery. You can do that, and the goal is to try to do that as much as you can. And you can see it's pretty high. It's somewhere between 98% and 100%. Certainly an OpCab, it's no less. And then as far as how well the grafts stay open, again, they tend to do as well or better, beating hard or not. No benefit. I won't go through all the busyness of the slide because we've already talked about it a little bit. But just to sort of summarize, reduces infection, reduces blood transfusions, reduces the time that you have the breathing tube in. It's really interesting, not having had surgery, but talking to a lot of patients. When I thought about the patients who we operate on that have formerly had heart surgery, so these are repeat operations, and I'd go through my usual, what I think is pretty detailed, complete discussion with the patient, and I tended to focus more on the stuff that I expected to focus on. Let me talk to you about how the operation will occur. Let me talk to you about what we're specifically going to do as far as bypasses and veins and arteries and that kind of stuff. And let me tell you what I think your risk of having these complications are. And the patients tended to have this type of response, which is, yeah, okay, Dr. Allen, I get it. You know, I've already been through the dance once. This is my second time around. But I really don't want to have that breathing tube in anymore. So I thought about that after a while. I go, wow, that's a pretty remarkable response. Because here I am talking about their mortality and risk of death and whatever. And they tend, as a group, to accept that pretty well. But they really hated having that breathing tube down. So that's going to be a pretty bad thing in the universe for someone to kind of get by the whole mortality stroke risk and focus on, oh my God, I'm going to have a breathing tube in my throat. So that is one of the motivations that we've used for that rapid extubation protocol that we talked about, where they never know they had a tube in most of the time. I'm not trying to suggest that's everybody, because some people that's not the case, but what we call on an intent to treat basis, my intent is always to take that breathing tube out. And as long as it's safe for the patient to have that done, which it is in about 80% or more, it's done, and it's a pretty remarkable thing, and it reduces their anxiety and it reduces some other issues that we talked about. Incomplete revascularization, that talks about how many bypasses you can do. I will tell you, on average, whether it's beating heart surgery or it's traditional heart-lung machine surgery, we do about 3 bypasses on average. And it's also a pretty interesting marketing challenge to the patients when you go in there and you tell somebody, oh my God, you need a triple bypass. Everybody was like, oh my God, a triple bypass. Well, they're almost all triple bypasses, actually. It just sounds a lot. The average is 3. You know, sometimes you do 4, 5, 6, but you know, usually it's between 3 and 4. It's pretty uncommon that we get the opportunity to do only a single or a double bypass. Those tend to be better managed either with medicines and or stents sometimes. So just to give you a little bit of perspective, you know, they're all triple bypasses pretty much. Is there an opportunity to improve? Absolutely there is. You can see on the left side, the lighter blue slide, talks about the percentage of patients that are using it, you know, physicians that are using it or have used it versus where they were, and what percentage of total operations does that occur. So what does that tell you? I mean, mostly it tells you that only about 27% or so of either surgeons or programs have adopted this type of strategy to coronary artery disease. And you think about this and you go, well, why wouldn't everybody do that, right? I mean, this is just a better way to do things. I know Dr. Allen's a pretty good guy, just gave you some pretty helpful slides with some very good data to support it. And there's two reasonings behind it. One is, it's just harder to do, you know, quite frankly. To use that example about the mechanic trying to fix the engine in your car, you could either fix the car running or you can fix the car turned off. I think every mechanic's gonna go with turned off, you know, versus turned on, unless you can show them some evidence to support the idea that fixing it with the car on is better. And I'd like to think I've done that, or at least given you some interesting ideas to think about. Where there's been a lot of resistance, and the one thing that I told you is still unclear, is does beating heart surgery reduce mortality? We talked about that 2% risk. Studies would suggest it does, but it's not a very strong thing. It's not like it goes from 2% to 0%. But it's really not just about mortality. I think we, as a system, have accepted mortality is very good. We will always work to do better, but it's kind of hard to improve on 2%. But all these other items that we talked about, transfusions, pneumonia, atrial fibrillation, length of stay, wound infections, things like that, they're all better in beating heart surgery. So a lot of people have dismissed those as, oh, it's not that big a deal to get a unit of blood. It's not such a big deal if the patient has to be in the breathing machine for an extra day. It's not a big deal if they need to be in the ICU or the hospital for another 1 or 2 or 3 days. These are big deals. These are big deals for the patients, and these are big deals for the hospital systems that we employ. This is, again, a little bit more of a physician-based slide, but talks a little bit about the benefits in OPCAB in the higher-risk patients. I think we've touched on it. The one added piece of information maybe to focus on, or maybe the two added pieces of information. One is taking a look at the patients who are over 70 years old, okay, which a growing number of our patients are. And then the other one is the patients for reoperation that we talked about, patients that are coming back for a second operation that have higher risks. Just other broad societal recommendations, ISMICS, which I'm a member of, International Society, Minimally Invasive Cardiac Surgery, sounds pretty good, but you know, this is a international base of what I would call progressive or contemporary care. Cardiac surgeons have kind of come around to the conclusion that this is a good thing to do, and these are just some ideas about how we pick those patients. Most systems, even though I showed you the slide earlier, where about 27% or so of physicians or programs, you know, will use this technique, it's not like one hospital or one physician does it 27% of the time. The better programs, in my view, are the ones that try to do it 100% of the time. Either you do it or you don't. It's just that not that many of them do it. So what you tend to find is you have a lot of programs where it's 0% in use, 0% in use, 100% in use, 0% in use. So it averages out to about 27% nationally. So just to kind of give you a little idea, then just about the ideology of the program. There are some physicians and some centers which are more renowned for this type of technique. There are other things, whether it's small incision valve surgery, conservative blood management, but specifically that's the way the numbers sort of shake out here. We think that we could do a better job in taking care of the number one health risk to people in this country, and we think we could do it better with OPCAB than with traditional methods. Right now, I'll go ahead and pause. I'll finish this part of my didactic and let you answer any questions that you might have. The question was, is there a problem with diabetics that are going into heart surgery? The short answer is yes, but the good news is most of our patients are diabetic. So if you take a look at, you know, people have blocked arteries for a reason, you know, and it's usually the same complex that has been true since measured medical time until right now. Diabetes, obesity, family history, high cholesterol, stress. I think I got them. I hope I got them all. Those are the contributing factors. So certainly diabetes is up there. If you take a look at current national data, about 27% of patients who get heart surgery are diabetic. More progressive data, there is a screening methodology that we use now, and I did this in response to this scenario. I'd operate on patients. They had no known history of diabetes. We would operate on them, and then after about a day or two, it became very apparent to everybody they were diabetic. So then you deliver the news, you know, Mr. Smith, just want to let you know that, you know, you're diabetic, and we're going to have to treat you as such. And the answer used to be, well, I'm not diabetic. You know, no one ever told me I was diabetic. You made me diabetic. You know, and they get this idea of, well, you know, and I kind of get it, you know, I wasn't diabetic when I came in here, now I'm diabetic, so I don't believe you. And or, when I'm healed from this, I'm going to go back to being non-diabetic, right? I get that a lot, right? That's standard denial, it's a lot of things. But I kind of got the thinking, because, you know, if you didn't know you're diabetic and now you were, you want to blame somebody. So we're very fortunate to have relatively new technology that we've included in our order system. There's a test you may have heard of, probably heard of, called hemoglobin A1C screening, and it's a great test. And what that test does is it takes about a 30-day snapshot of what someone's glucose control has been in their body. So this is a test that we get before every operation, and I've learned a couple things from it. One, frankly, it takes a lot of the heat off of me, because for the people that are now newly diagnosed, we get to interact with them before they have ever had surgery. Right, so there's no more excuse of you made me diabetic. You know, this is before I did anything, before anybody did anything. And this isn't just over, oh, I had a bowl of ice cream before I came in. Right, this is a 30-day snapshot. So whatever you did for 1 or 2 or 3 days before you came in is not going to have much effect on this. So we tend to diagnose a lot of new diabetics. I think that's one of the favorable things I bring to the system is doing a better job in disease management, not just heart disease, but diabetes. So where that comes into your question about are there problems with diabetics and how many are there, well, I started to tell you that traditional data tells you about 26% of heart surgery patients are diabetic. Those are known diabetics, right? When you do hemoglobin A1C screening, you pick up about another 25% or so. So you find out that about half of our patients, they're diabetic. So in a similar thinking, I treat everybody like they're diabetic, right? Not in the sense that they get insulin, but in the sense of their diet, and in a sense of their wound management, for the same methodology we talked before. Treat everybody like they're the highest risk patients. No one is gonna have a negative effect because they get a diabetic diet for a week. They're not gonna like the food no matter what I do, But at least I can make sure they're not going to have their glucose management negatively affected. So the first thing we do is we tend to diagnose a lot of new diabetes. It's a good thing for the patient, right? I want to know that because I know that one of the determinants of good long-term outcome is their diabetes management. I could feel great about it. I fixed something that was broken, send them home. If their glucose control is poor for the next 2 months or 2 years, they'll be back. Something bad's going to happen. It's like I just gave you a new engine in your car, but you decided you didn't want to change the oil. You'll be back. So that's one thing you learn. The other thing you learn is among patients that are known diabetics, and this is, I think, equally as important, you talk to the patient, you look at their history. Oh, yeah, I'm diabetic. You know, I take these two medicines. Or my favorite answer is I'm diet controlled. You know, that's like not being controlled for most people. How do I know that? Because we do a screening and test on them. And let's just say the number is supposed to be somewhere between 5 and 7. Let's call that the green zone. And I love the patients that say, oh, yeah, this is my diet and these are my medicines. And they come in at like 11, you know, which is really, really not good. So it's an opportunity to educate them and to improve in their care. So it's a good way to help take care of these patients. Because if you take a look at the entire hospital, not just heart surgery patients, probably about a third of the patients are either diabetic or pre-diabetic or undiagnosed diabetics. All right. Well, I'm more interested in the I'm married twice and both your husbands have had heart surgery. I don't know if it says stuff about them or says stuff about you, but you're here, they're not, so I'll answer your question. And the question was, do you still have to break the sternum? For traditional bypass surgery, the answer is yes. For other types of operations, for valve surgery, or certainly for a lot of lung surgeries we do, you know, you can do many of those operations through an incision about that big. In the unlikely event, we do get one of those patients that I mentioned earlier where it's just a single vessel bypass. We could also tend to do a much smaller incision. The lay public is always bombarded with a lot of interesting kind of science, quasi-research stuff, and robotics, you know, tends to be one of them. And there'll be some story of, oh my God, I was dying, and this some surgeon who's not probably really a surgeon, he's a paid model, you know, sitting there taking a picture next to a robot, and I got 2 or 3 incisions, and isn't this all great? I will tell you, in the real world, you know, it doesn't really happen very often, if at all. There are about 400,000 open heart operations that are done in the United States every year. And I will tell you, there's probably somewhere between 500 and 1,000, you know, that get done in any meaningful, you know, robotic way with regards to bypass surgery. So it's much less than 1%. And those are very specifically chosen type of patients. So I hope that technology advances to where I could tell you a year from now or 10 years from now, a couple of husbands from now, that that's something that we could do, you know, on a routine basis. But for traditional bypass surgery, you know, they're still more, they're not as big as incisions as they used to be. I mean, they used to be these shark bite level, you know, stem to stern kind of incisions. Also, which I didn't talk about today, the bigger incisions actually used to be the incisions on the legs. You know, if you take a look at heart surgery patients going back, you know, not very long ago, 5, 10 years ago, they used to have incisions which pretty much went from their groin to their ankles. You know, and those really had a bigger morbidity than even the chest incisions. Now, most leg incisions, there's 1 or 2 of them about that big or so. So the question was the effects of inadequate sleep on cardiac disease and how that affects things. Well, there's certainly a huge amount of clinical data now that does support, you know, adequate rest in a lot of important methodologies. You know, one for obesity, you know, we tend to, if you don't get adequate rest, and I spent the entire 1990s not sleeping, you know, in residency, so I could speak to this personally. When you don't get adequate rest, and people will debate what the number is, you know, it goes anywhere from 6 hours to 9 hours a night is what you're supposed to get. How many of you get that on a regular basis? Not very many, probably. And when you don't get that level of sleep for a long period of time, that's a stress response to the body. Doesn't matter how you think you respond to it, doesn't matter whether you've got it all together and I only need 3 hours, 5 hours. You know, there's some cold hard math about being a human being that you just need. You know, you have to have a certain body temperature, you have to have a certain blood pressure, and you have to get a certain amount of rest. That doesn't mean every single day, but it has to sort of average out that way. So now you think about it, let's just say, for example, you're supposed to get 7 hours and you get 4 hours, right? So that's a little bit of a stress to the body. You know, because maybe you had a bad day, something happened. And now you do that for 2 days. Now you do that for 2 months. Now you do that for 2 years, right? So it's a little bit like the governor or the idle in your car, right? And say it's car's supposed to idle at 800 RPMs. right? But your car's not idling at 800 RPMs. It's idling at 1,000 RPMs, right? That's not a big deal, right? I mean, it doesn't really affect the way you drive. You don't really get too excited. You say, oh, my car idles a little bit higher. So how long do you think that engine's going to last? Think it's going to last the same as the engine that's idling at 800? No, of course not, right? Heart's an engine. So that's just one, you know, example. You know, the question is, did that contribute to your atrial fibrillation and or to your mitral valve disease? I will tell you the answer is probably not, quite frankly. You may want me to say yes, but I'm just going to say no, because where I think it could contribute is coronary artery disease, because valve disease and artery disease, for the most part, are very separate types of issue. In other words, artery disease almost always comes from the accumulation of some type of cholesterol plaque, which can come from the metabolism of cholesterol, which can come from certain genetic predispositions. Valve disease has nothing to do with cholesterol metabolism for the most part. Valve disease, and people ask, well, why did my valve not work anymore? It's the same type of answer, why doesn't my hip or ankle or back or knee work anymore? Right? Because we are made of biomaterials and they break down over time. And valves, if you ever get a chance to see one, they are a biomaterial not that dissimilar than the cartilage in any other place in your body that's got cartilage, and they wear down. You know, the heart beats 70 times a minute for 50 years. You know, you think about it, it's incredible it works as well as it does for as long as it does. So probably not stress related. Atrial fibrillation?
Yeah.
It's hard to say. You know, in the biz, we call it AF, because okay. I would do the same thing. So the question is just sort of a general overview of atrial fibrillation. Well, I'll first start off by telling you what it's not, right? It's not ventricular fibrillation. So what's fibrillation at all? When they teach it to you in medical school, and if you've seen it, it's what we call a bag of worms view of the heart. So the heart is made up of multiple muscle fibers, and they're all supposed to work in conjunction, right? And if you kind of think of my fingers as part of those muscle fibers, it's supposed to do this. When you get fibrillation, which is really just an abnormal electrical activity of the heart, instead of doing this, it does this. Looks like a bag of worms kind of moving around. So as you might imagine, the first thing that happens is the efficiency of the pump goes down, right? Because you're not doing this, you know, you're doing something other than that. So that's the first thing that people will notice. If that happens in the ventricle, which is the big muscular bottom part of the heart, you die, you know. That's pretty much it. It's a short discussion. That is the most common endpoint in what we call sudden cardiac death. You know, it's the story of, we all know them, right? So-and-so went to sleep, never woke up. Went for a walk, never came back. You know, most of that is ventricular fibrillation for whatever the course is. You know, it could be a lot of different things that got you there, blocked arteries being most common. So that is not, however, your question, which is atrial fibrillation. So what I just described to you were the big pumping chambers on the bottom of the heart. Atrial fibrillation, or the atria, are the smaller pumping chambers on the top of the heart. And they only contribute somewhere between 10 and 15% of what we call the cardiac output. So think about the horsepower in your car. You know, if these things went out, the horsepower would go, say, from an average of 200 to maybe 170 or 180, something like that. You feel it, you know, if you're driving pretty hard, but it doesn't mean the car breaks and you can't use it anymore. It's not even so much that part. It's what causes it and how does it mean we take care of patients differently. What causes it, no one is entirely sure, but it appears to be a degenerative disease. Right, we talked a little bit about arteries degenerate and valves degenerate. Well, within the muscle of the heart, the electric system degenerates. Okay, there are multiple electrical nerve impulses. Right, and the one you're most familiar with is what we call the pacemaker. Right, pacemaker is a real thing in the heart. It's not like a little metal box, but it is a real part of the heart where electrical impulses come in actually from the brainstem, feed into the heart that help regulate heart rate and blood pressure. In that general area, you get breakdown of these electrical fibers, right? We've seen it in our daily consumer lives, right? You have an electric cord hooked up to anything in the world, right? Grab that cord and start pulling on it a little bit, right? And then look at the light, right? Before the cord completely snaps, the light's going to start to change. It's going to flicker, it's going to get a little dimmer, and then it's going to go dark, right? That's pretty much what happens with the electrical system in the heart. You know, it's not all or none, start or stop always. It's going to go into atrial fibrillation, right? It's going to go into heart failure, and one day it might stop. So that is the general thinking. It is a degenerative disease. It has nothing to do with your diet. It has nothing to do with whether you're running 5 miles a day or not running at all. The question becomes, well, how do we take care of it? What does it mean? As I talked earlier, there are a couple of ideas about it. What it means is, if you take a look, and I mentioned, I think, a little bit, is, and this is not a shock number, but this is a real number, it increases your mortality by 100% in a given year. Right? It's pretty compelling stuff. What does that mean? It doesn't mean you're going to die from it tomorrow. What that means is, you know, pick anybody, include myself. Let's just say, for example, I have a 1% chance of dying this year. All causes, getting hit by lightning, heart disease, cancer. If you have atrial fibrillation and nothing else is different, now I have a 2% chance of dying. That's what it means. You know, it's pretty significant stuff. The most common reason people die from it, if it is untreated, underlining untreated, is they die from stroke, and they die from a blood clot going someplace bad, like their gut or their kidneys or heart. When you do treat it, you can reduce somebody's longevity back to near normal. You know, it's not perfect. How you treat it, you know, first line of therapy is medicines, blood thinning type of medicines, medicines that control heart rate. If that doesn't work, I'll come back and give you a talk another time about heart surgery. There are surgical interventions. Dr. Bryce probably, for any of you that were here last month, probably talked about it. There are other interventional mechanical ways to fix these things. That's really for a relatively small group of patients, but it's actually very helpful for those group of patients. Well, the question is, what's the difference between atrial fibrillation and VTAC? So, you know, the A part, you guys are going to be much more educated when you leave here. You know, you'll impress your family, call your kids, tell them what you learned today. So there's the atrial part and the ventricular part. So with regard to AFib and VTAC, I think is what you said. Is that right? So ventricular tachycardia, just like a tachometer, you know, I learned a lot of Latin from doing medicine. And just like the tachometer in your car, which measures, you know, the RPMs, so it's the idea of speed. So ventricular tachycardia means that the bottom part of the heart, the ventricles, are going faster than they should be. It's kind of an idle story, like I talked about before. Ventricular fibrillation is, you know, that's like the final countdown. You know, you're going to die in a few minutes or a few seconds. Ventricular tachycardia may or may not be that. So that's the idling story on the ventricle. The ventricle is supposed to fire at 70, 80 times a minute, and now you're going at 130 or 140 times a minute. That could be caused by a number of different things. That could be caused by inherent electrical problems in the heart. You know, that could go to other things, atrial fibrillation and VFib. That could be caused by certain types of medicines, okay? And that could be caused by other types of disease states, you know, for people that are septic, people that have bad pneumonia, things like that. No, the question was about the study of VTAC and one of the ways you manage it. When you're trying to find out how to best take care of somebody, specifically with arrhythmia problems, you know, they do what we call rhythm studies. So I'm sure you had the pleasure at some point in your life of where they brought you into the EP lab and they kind of shocked you and hooked you up to all sorts of electric stuff and tried to create certain problems so they could figure out how to treat them. And yours apparently were concerning enough to the people taking care of you where you got a very special, pretty expensive device called an AICD. So everybody's familiar with the paddles that you see people getting shocked with on TV and other places. This is a miniaturized version, kind of a pacemaker-sized version that gets connected into the heart. So when that event happens, and in you, even though you sense that it happens often, it doesn't happen often in the sense that it happens every day. You know, it happens a period of a few times a month, a few times a year kind of thing. And when they tested you, when it was left untreated, it deteriorated to something very bad, you know, major ventricular fibrillation or something like that. So your therapy is you get a little electric shock, and it resets you, and you do fine. So with regards to the procedure, with regards to beating heart surgery, is that specifically? Yeah, so the question was, does beating heart surgery, is that something that patients can find, you know, locally? And the answer is soon to be yes. We are sort of at the precipice of getting ready to start our open heart surgery program here at Waterman Hospital, and that will be one of the cornerstones, probably the cornerstone, as far as the cardiac side of the program. Other than that, I think there's maybe a small pocket of it that occurs at Florida South. And then after that, really, you have to kind of go to Tampa before there would be a center, you know, where I would feel comfortable recommending somebody. All right, thank you all very much for coming.